But yeah, I mean, I hope that you can make the most of this presentation. As you know, we're going to be talking about Docker a little bit. We're not going to go too deep into detail, but I'm happy to after, okay, if you want to reach out to me. So we're going to be talking about how to integrate Docker in our Drupal environments. I know some of you already, I've been talking to you, which has been great, meeting many of you over the weekend. For those of you who still don't know me, I'm Frank. I work for Amazing Labs. Those are my email, my Drupal profile. I haven't got Twitter, but feel free to reach out to email anytime you want. I'm happy to answer any questions. What are we going to be talking about today? So, quick intro, then we're going to be really focusing on the Docker setup. That's going to be the really meaty part of the presentation. We're going to be doing a real life example. I was going to do a live demo, as you just did before, but I was covered, so I decided to record it just in case, because I had yesterday some Wi-Fi issues, so I just decided to record it. And then we just close up the session with some pros and cons and some more questions. So, be good. Okay, so the very first thing, I mean, some people in fact were talking to me before, decide, do I really need to know Docker to be in your presentation? The answer is easy, no, okay? If you don't know Docker, you will understand way better this presentation. But if you don't know Docker, this can be a very good entry point for you, so you can maybe start playing with it, and you can get some good things out of this presentation. A quick note on environments. I put this same slide yesterday in one of my presentations, but again, I want to go through it because it's something that I consider important. Depending on the size of the project, depending on the size of the company, and depending on the skill set of the people working on the team, you might be working on one of these situations. So I know that there's people who directly work in production, they just SSH into the server, they just open Vim and start hacking codes. I think any of us would have done it at some point in our lives, feeling bad, but we still do it. But I'm going to discard that one, okay? So it's not really what we should be doing. More typical situations, depending on the above factors, are to have a development environment and then a production. If maybe we're talking of small projects, small company, okay, we don't have many resources, so we just have dev and prod. If we're going to go a bit improve that kind of workflow, I mean, what happens when we have multiple developers all working on development? We can be overriding database configuration, we can be overriding loads of things. So it's kind of a better approach to go to have local environments in which that says is my local machine. I can go wild, I can delete data, I can try out new things. If I break something, it won't be the end of the world. So having local then development and then production is a kind of more common scenario. But then again, coming back to that beginning, size of project, size of company, we can have also multiple other environments. It could be staging. It could be maybe an environment per branch, if you can afford it. If you can afford it, you can just create a PR out of a branch and then trigger a whole new server. So yeah, these are the things that I'm going to be considering. We're going to be mostly focusing on this one, but because we're talking Docker, we can go wild to the environments, okay? Because we can just spin up as many as we want, and it's going to be really easy. So, which options do we have for local? I think this has been changing a lot over the years, and I think it has been changing for good. Many years ago, that was the only option. Who has not used that? Probably nobody, okay? That means that we've all used it at some point, whether it's Windows, Linux, Mac. We've used the MAMP version of it, the WAMP version of it. Because that was the easiest way to sort of put something that resembles a server into our local machine. So we've all done it. It did the job for quite some time, but obviously it had a lot of limitations. We needed to have some knowledge. once you wanted to have more than one project, then you needed to know what a vhost is. So that means that you need to know a little bit about Apache or about Nginx. I mean, in this case, Apache, because it's a pump. So you need to be a bit technical, and maybe some people would struggle with that. But anyway, as I said, they did the job, they were good, so and probably they set up the foundation for many of the following tools. A tool that came a few years ago as well is Vagrant, and has everybody used it? Most of us, up to a point, okay. It was an improvement, okay. It's giving us a virtual machine that we can just SSH. It's not our local machine. And that means that somehow, if we get a good background image, we can get a similar setup to what the production server is. What happens when we have multiple projects? Then we need to go into Apache configuration, so it's a Linux machine, so we need to kind of know a little bit of DevOps. So you can potentially do it, there's loads of information, but again, maybe some people could struggle. And also one of the things is resources of the machine. Okay, it was a whole virtual machine, so it would consume resources. And also, another thing, what if I've got a front-end project and a back-end project? What if one of my projects is using React front-end with Drupal back-end and another is fully Drupal? The configuration for those vehicles is really different. What if I need Nginx for one, Apache for another? So that's when things start to get a bit tricky. We could also go like set up cloud servers and then maybe SFTP. I think we've all done it at some point as well. There are some other cool options as well, like Valet. That's a tool which is created for Laravel, but it works pretty well with pretty much any PHP theme that you put in it. Has somebody used Valet, or at least heard of it? You can just Google it. It's most probably you haven't heard of it because it's for Laravel, but it's really cool. I mean, you can easily set up multiple vhosts with minimal configuration, which is good. So yeah, you can give it a go, it's still out there. We can even use the PHP built-in server. I mean, say that we have a cloud database, so we can always use the PHP server and have the project up and running in Drupal. That's probably the quickest, cheapest option. But yeah, obviously it doesn't allow you for too much configuration. Well, many others, and also we have Docker. That's probably the reason why most of you are here today. Okay, we have Docker. Docker is, I don't want to say the new kid on the block because it's been here already for quite some time. But it's definitely gaining on popularity. What is Docker? Basically, at the end of the day, it is a tool that is allowing me to develop locally. That's what all the other tools we've been mentioning were doing. So that's what we are kind of using Docker. We're doing many, many, many more things with Docker, because the technology allows, and that's great. We're going to be talking about a few of them as well. But the end goal, remember, is we're going to try to set up our local environment. There are really many options. I'm just going to be naming a few. So Amazy.io, I know that one because they are the hosting guy host us in Amazy. So I know about that. Then we have Docker for Drupal, which is a fully open source solution that anybody can use it. And then we've got Lagoon, which is again done by Amazon, but this is fully open source as well. They are growing in popularity and they are creating more and more documentation, so that's really good. And the setup is very, very similar to the Docker for Drupal. We can always use custom Docker images, so if you know a bit more about Docker, you can create your own images. So Docker is basically it's like a central library in which we can put loads of images. So they are like, imagine that for a prod server we have Ubuntu 16.04. So there is a Ubuntu 16.04 in Docker image that we can just download, and that will be an exact copy of what the prod server will have. And what if we want PHP 7.1? There is a Docker image for that. I can just download, and it's exactly the same package as it's using the prod server. And what about MariaDB or MySQL? There's an image for that. So with Docker, the cool thing is that it works in kind of layers. You can choose the layers that you want. And the cool thing about Docker is that it will connect all of them for you. Obviously, it needs a bit of configuration. We will talk about it later. they would join all those things. And what if I want Redis? What if I want Blackfire? What? There are images for everything, and you can put them all together. You can make them talk to each other very, very easily. And with that, one of the greatest things is that you can get an identical setup to production. Easy as that, okay? So your production server, your local server is a 100% copy of what production is. And just making a quick note in there, like Docker in production. Have you ever heard of that, using Docker in production? So it's kind of becoming a thing, okay? People say it's risky, people are brave and they try, the ones that they think that is not so risky. So why not? Anyway, we'll come back to that at the very end of the presentation. But I just wanted to kind of put it in there. Food for thought. A little bit about my day-to-day, so that you understand what my context is, and probably the main reason why I was giving this talk, why I wanted to give it. So I work in maintenance and support. Basically, in Amazing, we have like three big teams that they work with the big projects, 6, 9, 1 year development. But once they finish, those projects need maintenance. And all those projects that are finished and need maintenance or extensions or whatever, they come to my team. Okay, I work in the global maintenance team, and that's basically what we do. We inherit projects from the big developers, and we just try to keep them up and running as best as we can. Okay, so how does Docker help me with that? So it could be one of the greatest things is quick setup and task switching. That is a big thing for me. On any normal day, I can work on easily 3 to 6 projects. I'm not exaggerating at all. There are days that I work in more than that. Not normally, but any given day in my daily work, I can be switching between 3 to 6 different projects, doing different things for them, deploying to the different environments and all that. And on any given week, our team, we work with up to between 15 to 20 projects. That is a lot of context switching, okay? Many developers in our other teams, they work with the one project, which you set up, you work on it, you focus, you lock down, and then you're good. But in our case, because of our context, we need to do a lot of context switching. Can you imagine setting up all that with MAMP or with Vagrant or one of those previous tools we talked about? It could be a huge nightmare, because also what I mentioned before, those projects, they don't have similar setups. Some of them use Apache, some of them use Nginx, some of them use Node for rendering the front end, etc., etc. So it's a lot of setup that would be needed, and it's a lot of task switching. In our team, some of us are kind of all-round Drupal developers, so whatever you throw at me, I will try to do it. But not everybody in my team is the same. We have front-end people, we have back-end people, and we have junior people as well. What happened with those junior people? Are we going to tell them to configure Docker? No way. They will just run away from the room. Okay? And so in that case, we need to make it easy for them, which is important. When we are talking about maintenance, about support, one of the key things is replicating what's happening. I'm pretty sure that some of us, or many of us, a client has reported a problem and said, this is happening. Okay, I tried to do it locally. It works. Okay, let's try in there. But it works. Let's try in the staging. But it works. It's like, there's no way I cannot replicate. So one of the key things for us as well is to be able to have an exact setup, to have pretty much the same context, to have the same files, to have the same closest thing that we can get to the prod server without hacking or going to the prod server, okay? So that is really important as well. Another key thing, coming back to these 3 to 6 projects or up to 20 on any given week, is the computer resources. I've got a really nice looking good Mac, but it still has limited memory, it has limited storage, it has limited everything. So I really need to pay attention to those things. So one of the cool things about Docker is that resource-wise, is probably the least consuming from all the other options we were talking before. And then last, I think it's last, but probably probably not least. I don't know if there is any other point. Yeah, last, cool. We all need a common setup, okay? We are, even if we're working in maintenance, our team is nearly 10 people, and we all need to have a common understanding, a common ground, so that we are all able to work within the same constraints and the same kind of setup. So that's why, and that's where Docker helps us, okay? So that's kind of our context, but I'm pretty sure that one way or another, you can adapt what I'm going to say to your individual context. It might be that you're working two projects. I don't want to install MAMP. Why do I need to install MAMP in my machine? Yeah, mess up with all that. So I'm pretty sure that you can still take something out of it, even if your context is different, which will probably be. So before going in, how do I set up any given project, a few useful aliases that we use. So if you've, if some of you have been using Docker already, you're typing a lot of stuff in there. Whether it's Docker Compose or Docker Run or whatever, you're typing long commands. So we're just trying to make our life easier, and we're trying to abstract a little bit the complexity for some of the people that understand Docker a bit less. So we have vSQL command. What is that vSQL command? Okay, so that vSQL is just, in this case it's not even Docker related, it's DRUS, okay? And that is running DRUS, SQL sync, argument, default. Does somebody know what DRUS SQL sync do? Any of you would say? Go on.
It syncs two databases from two different instances of websites.
Yeah, exactly. So that command will sync databases across environments. First argument is, where do I want the database from? Second argument, where do I want that database to? Okay? So we abstract it, because what if a junior developer puts the arguments the other way around and put default to prod? It would be pushing the local database to prod, so it's kind of risky. So we want to abstract some complexity and say, okay, just use vSQL prod, and that means that you want the prod database, vSQL dev, and that means that you want the dev database. And very similar for D files, okay? We don't want to be uploading files to the prod server from local or from dev. So we do DRUS rsync, which is basically just syncing files using the rsync command. And we also use other aliases like dssh. We're talking Docker, and to be honest, there is no such thing as ssh into a Docker image. But there is a thing which is connecting to the Docker image that runs the bash commands. And that is the closest thing that we do when we SSH into the dev server, or that we do when we do when we go into the prod server. So again, we do use this DSSH just for connecting to our local instance to simulate that you are SSHing into a server. And if you want to do it as root, you can have that. Docker Composer app -d, that would be the app, okay? We're just trying to be brief, and again, a junior person, if we just tell them do the app and that we do something, then we said, okay. If we tell them Docker Composer, but I don't know Docker, what do we do now? Okay. So we are trying to kind of abstract that from people. But at the end of the day, even for people who understand Docker, it's easier and quicker. The stop to stop the container, the down to just completely eliminate it. GPS, I use just that one to see all the images that I got running at any given time. As I said, the slides, they will be completely available online already, so you can check all that. I know that it's kind of small, but I put all the aliases in there that I use. And basically, they are like Docker Compose Down, Docker Compose Up, etc., etc. So I'm going to be referring to these aliases during the presentation. That's why I wanted to sort of introduce them briefly. What else do we need to keep on working with Docker? This is still not totally Docker, but because we're talking Drupal, I think it's important to set this up. Okay, so we're going to need to set up this file, aliases.drus.php. I put the drupal.org link. And basically, this is just an extract of that file. You don't need to read it at all, but basically, you can also see that it's an array, and that array has a key and some SSH settings. So as you can see in here, is aliases local, aliases dev, aliases prod, And then we've got the prod URL, we've got the remote user, the remote maybe password, or all these sort of things. And I can set all kind of options. As I said, the link is in there. That is just a small excerpt of the file that they put in there. So it is important to configure that file. It will make your life easier later on. Remember that the end goal of this presentation is to have a full Docker workflow set up so that it can ease up and speed up the whole switching of environments, setting up, and all that. The other file, settings.php, we all know about that one. How is that file kind of important? Again, it's probably too small, you cannot see it, but anyway, I'm going to tell you what's in there. Basically, that array is the database configuration. Are you putting your database credentials on settings? Are you committing settings? Yeah, we are. Because in this case, we're using server variables to that contain those values. So we have a server environment variable that has the database username and a server variable that contains the database password. So the only thing we need to do when we are having a Docker container is to make sure that that server has that variable. Easy as that. And in that sense, we can fully commit those settings file. Anyway, later on, we're going to go into a bit of a more complex settings file setup. But in this case, what you can see in there is the minimum working piece of work that we need to have it all working. And that is just using the getM function from PHP that reads the server variable. Cool, and what else? We need yet one more file, which is just rc.php. And the only reason why we need that is so that Drush play nice with many of the commands.
Make it a bit bigger.
I can't because basically it's of the rooms that I've been in have a different resolution. I'm sorry about that. I'm not expecting you to read, to be honest. I mean, the slides are available. I just put the code snippets because I think they could be useful later on, okay, if you want to check them. Basically, the only thing that that file has is options URL, and it's giving the URL of the server. And that's just useful because when in Drush, we run, for example, Drush status, if we don't put that, it will say that the URL of my site is HTTP default, and if we put that, it will put a fully qualified URL, which is useful. Anyway, I mean, I knew that I was dumping here a lot of code. I wasn't expecting you guys to read it. I want you to understand that we're setting up these three files that will make our life easier down the line, okay? So I apologize for that, but I mean, I cannot think this would happen. Okay, so we've got the aliases set up, we've got those files. Let's start let's go to the main thing. Okay, the first thing I'm gonna do is the app. What did that do? That just kicked the container up, so we have we just start the Docker container, and then I will do the SSH. So now I am inside the container, so the very first thing, I'm assuming that we all have the source code, okay? We have this cloning, we're in the right branch, etc. Okay? So that's, I think, are we following until that, or? Yeah, so we've got the code, we've started the container, and we've kind of SSH into my local server. So the first thing I'm gonna do is think in the database, okay? So every time that we're setting a local project, that's one of the first steps, where there is mount, background, virtual machine. We need to sync the database. So for that, if you remember, we had a command. Very small. Too much.
And this is not main.
Is it messing up?
Okay. Oh my.
Cool, so I'm running this, this is just a Drush command, it stands for Drush site aliases. And if you remember, we were setting up an aliases file before with a few entries in an array. That's pretty much what it's listing. So it's telling me the aliases that are defined. So in this case, we've got local, which is usually default, and dev and prod, okay? So if I want to sync the database, if I want to get an exact 100% copy of the database, I just need to do SQL prod, and that will connect the prod server. It will run this SQL synchronization command, and it will bring it to my local Docker copy. End of it. That's everything I need to do to have a which I think is easier to have PHP MyAdmin enabled, run on an export that could be 20 megs, could be 300 megs, could be whatever more. And then yeah, the other possibility would be just to use the native trust command. But again, we're just trying to stay away from that just for safety reasons. Some people that might have been working on Docker is like, what about persistence on the database? As soon as you stop the container, database is gone. Probably, if people have been using Docker, they have already experienced that. If you haven't and you don't do anything about it, that's probably one of the downsides of Docker. It's really good, it's really fast, it consumes very little resources, because as soon as you stop it, it destroys the resources. Okay, so I've brought a whole database, I stopped the container, and now my database is gone. That's not saving me any time if I need to sync the database every single time. So that's where the volumes, sorry about the arrows overlapping, that's where the concept of volumes on Docker come from. Again, I'm not going to go too much into detail, but adding something like this into a Docker file that we're going to be talking later on, that would solve the issue. That would make sure that if you stop the container, the database is still in there, you stop the project, you go on holiday for 2-3 weeks, you come back, 2-3 weeks later, you up the project, and the database is still there. And as you see, it's not really such a huge deal. We are just basically mounting a folder inside a Docker. I mean, you don't even need to know what's going on. You just add that and it works. It won't destroy the database. We're just trying to be practical here. And we can even export and expose the ports in case we want to use tools like MySQL Workbench or any sort of UI to check the database. We can still connect easily to it.
Can I just ask?
Yeah. Docker, it works pretty much like Git, in the sense that you download something, you can make changes to it, and then you can commit, you can push, you can have your local repos, you can have public available repos. In this case, that's not exactly what we're talking about, but yeah, I mean, it is possible. You can make changes to an image, and then just commit and save those changes for you, and they will be there next time that you use that image. So say that, for example, you just download the image for the OS, for Ubuntu, and then you want to configure yourself the whole MariaDB, PHP, or whatever, because you just feel comfortable with that, so you can just do it and save all those changes and reset the image. In this case, because we're going to be talking with kind of open source or publicly available images, we're not doing any of that, okay? So this is mainly focused towards a Drupal developer, okay? So, yeah, if you know Docker, you can do it. Cool. So the next thing, I already have the database. I know that database is not going to go away anytime. So the next thing will be syncing files. So we could do something as easy, again, as dfiles from prod. And that will bring all the files from prod. In one of my presentations yesterday, I mentioned what if I have 10 gigs of files, then don't run that command, because that means that you will have 10 gigs of files on your local machine. So you can maybe use the stage file proxy module. That way you don't need to download any file at all. And if the site is using any reference to a file, it will download it then and there. Okay? But you don't need to download the files beforehand. That's the link to the module. That's it. If you want to use this stage file proxy, you can easily set it up in one line of code, so that you don't need to kind of re-enable the module all the time, all that. So you can just have it enabled, and then with one line of code, you can either use it or not use it. Okay, we've got the database, we've got the files, what else do we need? Maybe my project is using Solr. Okay, so we're talking now, so far we've covered the basics of any Drupal site, which is code, database, and files. 90% of the cases, if the project is small, medium enough, you're done with that. You don't need to do absolutely anything else. But what if the configuration of the project starts to getting a bit more complex? So what if the project is using Apache Solr, or is using Elasticsearch, or is using any other thing? Okay. So in this case, very easy again to do it with Docker. So what we this will happen. Again, I'm gonna talk of what you are seeing. You don't need to read what you are seeing. Okay. I'm gonna tell you what you are seeing there. Again, apologize for that. It's screen resolution, some of these sort of things. But anyway, what we are just doing in there is there is a keyword in Docker in a Docker file, which is Docker Compose. We'll talk about that file at the end. That's a keyword which is services, which is basically which things are we downloading, okay, which things are we grabbing. In here that says Solr, and in there it says image Solr. So if you go to the Docker Hub and you type Solr, there is an image which is Solr, and that is the one we are downloading. Okay, we're not creating our own thing. We're using something that is already done and pre-configured for us. We're just exposing the port so that the containers can talk to each other, so that the Drupal container can talk to the Solr container. And then also we're mounting a volume. Remember that the volume was just making sure that something on my local thing is talking, is communicating with the Docker image. So in this case, we're mounting the folder Docker, whatever, 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 to another folder, Solr, whatever, 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 on the server, which is precisely where Solr, in this case, keeps the configuration. If it's an Elasticsearch, it will be other set of files. How does that translate? So basically, we just commit to version control, the Solr configuration, and that way we make sure that it's always there. It doesn't matter whether we are setting up dev, prod, local, staging. Configuration is there, use it, mount it, and that's the configuration that will be taken for Solr. And that's it. Reindex, you don't. So I remember, I think it was in DrupalCon, Vienna, somebody precisely was talking to me about this. It's like, yeah, we want to do these kind of things, but then when it comes to Solr and all that, we cannot do it because we are using this and this setup, and it's like, it's that easy. It's like, I mean, it's obviously you need to do some work, and you need to do somebody to explain you a little bit about that Docker bit, but it's, you see it's 3-4 lines of code, and then you have a full Docker instance up and running, pre-configured, and you just need to re-index it, and that's it, really. And for that you can just run a trash command, so you don't need to go through the UI. What about other integrations? So to be emails, we might be talking about, I mean, in this case for emails, so a service that we usually do is MailPop. We don't want actual emails to be coming out, so that service will capture every single email and it will just show it through a nice UI. What about Redis for caching? It's just, I'm actually putting the configuration that we need to add into the Docker file. As you see, emails, just 2 lines of code. Redis, we're just exposing a few environment variables and we're just connecting to the official Redis image. So it's 3-4 lines, adding a whole new service. If we will need to go through the actual setup in our local machine, it would be a nightmare. But doing that is dead easy. Varnish, Memcache, Node, Blackfire, you name it. Okay? So there is basically at the moment Docker images for pretty much everything. They're pretty helpful. And you can see that the setup is not usually complex. When you go and visit those images on Docker Hub, they even explain you what you need to do in order to integrate into your project. And then, yeah, another thing that could be really useful is, if you remember, we talked before about settings. So we commit settings.php to version control. Most of the people don't do it because it's got credentials, but we usually store the credentials on the on server environment variables. Okay? So again, you don't need to read it. I'm going to tell you what it says in there. So our settings file looks like that, really small, really tiny. And basically is if settings.all.php exists, include it. So that's the first block in there. Okay? That settings.all is not in there. So I won't show you it yet. The second block, it says get environment of the server. So if we're in production, that will say production, that will say development, or that will say local. And then what I do is, what we do is, if the file settings.development.php exists, we include it, otherwise we don't. And last but not least, we still want to have that possibility of not committing and sorting something to version control. If settings.local.php exists, include it, and we don't commit that to version control. So you can always have the stuff that you had in settings.php. We usually just dump it in there if there is any sensitive information, but we try to stay away from it. Okay, how do those files look like? So settings development, again, you cannot read it, but basically we are just masking the analytics code so that we don't communicate to Google Analytics. We are disabling all the cars. We are doing lots of things that are just specific for the development environment. Okay? We won't have that in the production file. And then the settings.all, basically, because remember we are committing that to version control, is all the environment variables that we have defined in the server, we dump them there. Okay, just because it's easy. And that's pretty much where we configure most of the services, like database, base URL, Redis, Solr, all these sort of things. They usually go there because we use and abuse environment variables that work for us. Might be that you do something else, it might be good, it might be better, so I'm more than welcome to listen to those other options. Good. Yeah, we're good. Okay, so a little bit of Drupal 7 versus Drupal 8. One of the differences with Drupal 8 is that we have a CMI, okay, configuration import export. And this is for real the actual workflow that we follow in our projects. So as I said before, we work with 15 to 20 projects. Easily still 60-70% of them are Drupal 7, the others are Drupal 8. And this is what we have when we are onboarding a ticket. So these are the instructions we actually follow. Okay? We clone the repo, we go into the folder, because it's D7 we're using submodules for the Drupal contrib modules and all that, the app, the SSH, and once I'm inside the container. So in this case, I'm just using stage 5 proxy. So the SQL from Trot, in the database, that's probably the operation that takes the longer. Depends on the database size and your connection. In this case, because it's a file stage proxy, we just create the files folder manually. We just give 777, we're in the local. Okay, and we just enable the module, draft CCOL, draft ULI to login as admin. We're done. Usually that process doesn't take more than, because in most of the cases, you don't do this every single time. You only do that when you need to debug that real problem that cannot be reproduced and all that. So if we take that out of the equation, we're talking of a 1 minute setup, 2 minutes setup of having nothing running on my machine to have a full URL available that I can develop and sync in to. So that's really quick. If we're syncing the database, in fact we're gonna see that later in the video that I recorded, it's gonna be around, 2 minutes total, something like that. Which is not such a huge deal. If you know that you're going to be working in that project, you just run the command. In fact, now something we are working on is just of, if you see all these are commands, so nothing is stopping you from putting it in a bash script and run it. So we're kind of working on that, so just, we just run the one script and it sets everything up from scratch. What would it look like on a Drupal 8 project? It's pretty much the same thing. We clone the repo, we go into the folder, the app, the SSH, but in Drupal 8, as we know, we have the wonderful Composer, so instead of bringing submodules and all that, we just run Composer install, and then again, if I need to sync the full database, I would run that. If I don't need to, I can just run configuration import, and that will bring the changes. And then again, I could use div files from prod, or I could use the stage 5 proxy, clear caches, ULI to get the admin login, and we're done. And as you see, I do this 5-6 times per day. I don't need to go through the whole command. For me, it's usually the app, the SSH, trust ULI, those three commands, and then I'm logging as admin, I can start developing. Resources-wise, I've had multiple instances running at the time. I've never had issues. I know I've got a powerful machine, but compared to Playground, compared to MAM, compared to other services, the amount of resources that is consumed, they are minimal. As I dataset, which is a video in a couple of slides. And then, okay, so I could have told you this in the very first slide, but I wanted to somehow grab your attention and you to listen to me about everything that was involved in adding these new services and all these other things. I told you at the very beginning you didn't need to know Docker, but I've been talking about Docker, Drus, things, so if some people say, you've been saying quite technical, I mean, hopefully most of you have been following me. If some of you think that it was very complex, all you need is obviously to have Docker installed, makes sense, and have that one file in your repo, Docker compose YAML file, and that file, in this case, Amaze.io, we have a custom image. I'm going to mention as well Lagoon, and I'm going to mention as well Docker for Drupal. I could keep on mentioning more and more and more and more, okay, because there are many providers, but I think these are good enough for you to keep going. So this is literally one of the images that we have for our Amaze.io setup. In this case, it's not very Dockery, because they just did it at the beginning of them learning Docker, and basically they did a background image inside a Docker sort of image, if you know what I mean, okay? So they configure everything, they save that image, and that is the image that we are downloading and pulling, okay? So it works. But you can still plug services, you can still plug Redis, you can still plug Mailhawk, you can still plug loads of other useful things. And if you see that file, it's 15 lines of code. I have no idea how to write that file. Okay, but maybe somebody in your team, or, I mean, again, if we're going down this route, that's open source, somebody has done it for you already. Somebody has given you step by step on how to do it. So you don't really need to worry about it too much. If you're interested in it, you can read about it, and you can just, just hack around, ask the DevOps team. I mean, in this case, we're lucky that we have a DevOps team that they do all that for us, so that we don't need to worry. But it's not really complex in that sense. I put the link in there, so it's available, all the documentation is available, and they explain a lot of really good and useful things, so I encourage you to go through it. Lagoon, that's completely open source, okay, so this one is, you need to eventually, if you want to use that, you need to pay them for their services, but these other options, they are completely open source, okay. Lagoon, this is starting to look more Docker, like the things I've been talking about previously. We have the keyword services. I mean, we see we have an image for the CLI, so just for connecting to the console. We have an image for Nginx. We have an image for whatever that is, I don't know. We have an image for PHP. We have an image for Redis. We have an image for Solar. We have an image for Varnish. We have loads of images. Dang, I'm not going to write that file. Somebody has drawn it for me. I just need to do the app, and it works. That's all the cool things about this. And you write it at the beginning, and you just don't need to worry about it anymore, unless the live server changes, in which case you can just edit this file, and that's about it. As I said, this is public open source, so you can just go through it. They are encouraging, and they are even using this in production as well, obviously in low risk projects, but they are using it in production, which is kind of cool. And then it's Docker for Drupal, that's the way I started as well, with Docker and Drupal. And it's a very similar setup to what we have in this Lagoon. So we have services like MariaDB, PHP, Nginx, Mailhawk. It's got, again, Redis available. We can see all those in there. You can go, I put the link, so that you can go to the actual site and see the file. And again, you put it on the root of your project. You run Docker Compose app, and you up and running with a copy. I mean, obviously, if you're using one of these predefines, it might not be an exact copy of your server, but it might very well be, because, for example, in this one, you can configure the PHP version that you have, and they've comment in and out some lines to change the MariaDB version, PHP version, which can be pretty useful. And literally, that's all you need. So real life, how much time do we have?
You're on it.
Okay.
2 minutes.
Okay, I think that's really, if you remember that was the D7, I just want to go through what's next. I think, to be honest, I'm going to skip the video. I'm more than happy, I in fact kind of show it to some people do I set up all that? And that's literally running those commands, and you can see that in 2 minutes, I've got the site up and running. That's about it, okay? So yeah, and that's my, I mean, that's a screen recording from my own machine a few days ago. So I'm just gonna go to the pros and cons, and I'm going to start with the cons. Initial configuration, obviously, we've been talking about that. But I think that if we go back to the alternatives, to MAM, to Vagrant, all those really need configuration as well. So it's not that we are really avoiding anything, we're just doing it in a different way. But the cool thing is that there is a lot of open source things in there, there's a lot of help available, and once you do it, it's really easy. Some people could say volatility. I don't think that's an issue, because now we have volumes, we can have redundancy, we can have many other options. I mean, if you don't want a risk database, you can always put it on an RDS image in Amazon, and that's it, really. So we've got options, I don't really see it as a problem. And then learning as well. Do I need to learn Docker? I can tell you, we've got juniors, we've got loads of people that they haven't got a clue about Docker, yet they use it on a daily basis, and they don't need to know. So I don't really think that there's a learning problem here. There is really, I mean, for the purpose of this talk, which is Docker is a Drupal environment, okay? If you want to learn Docker, then there is learning, true. But if you want to work with Docker, you don't need to know Docker, okay? And then finally, pros. So again, I cannot emphasize that enough. You can get an exact copy of prod, that's cool. It's really fast, it doesn't consume resources, you can have multiple containers running at the same time, and it's not really a problem. It's portable, it's open source, and then yeah, in there I'm giving you a link to a talk which is about using Docker in production. That was it, really. I mean, I really hope that you could make the most of this talk. I know I didn't go too much into detail into Docker, but to be honest, I can't, really, because I don't know too much. I know a little bit, I know my way around it, but I'm not an expert Docker developer. We have DevOps for that. So I really hope that you could make the most of the slides, which are available in there. So I encourage you to read them, go through the code, go through the links, and just investigate on the topic. So thank you all. I'm sorry that there's no time for questions, but I'm only available in here for lunch, so just for me if you need to.
Exactly. So I've got the Docker infrastructure running. It's all green lights. If you remember, there was this command which is just an alias which is showing what's running. At the moment, I have this. These are just services. Okay. So this is a project called Venture. I just showed you that file, and in here we have that URL. Okay.
Okay.
That URL is key because it's going to be talking to that DNS mask service, and that will make it available. It's like hooking up into the host file of your server. Thank you very much for that. Yeah, all good. Thank you. So yeah, Venture, you can see that it's not running. If I were to go to...
The Docker composes the Maze.io?
In this case it is. So if we just go through it, I mean, I just remove in there all the comments. But if you see, there are very few lines of code, and the main image that we are pulling from is an Amazi.io specific one, which is using PHP 5.6 and Solr. So they build it and they save it with that setup. As I said, if we visit venture.docker, whatever, it's not available. That means that the server is not running.